Hello and welcome to this week's edition of County Connection. I'm County Commissioner Kevin Barnhardt, and I'm without the services of Jean Toosey this evening. I think she wanted to see if I could do this solo, but thank you, Jean, for giving me the opportunity to be here and share some interesting things going on in Berks County. And as always, this is a call-in show. The number is 610-378-0426. 610-378-0426, and I encourage your calls. I'll try to go down through a laundry list of items that we're working on. I'll try to keep them in somewhat of chronological order so I don't lose you too much. One of the interesting things taking place tomorrow is a National Ag Day celebration at our Ag Center. It starts in the morning at 8:30, and there are programs throughout the morning. There are panel discussions from 8:30 to 9:45. Panel one is growing and selling. It's about local farmers and what they raise and sell locally. From 10 to 11:30 is Farm Market Managers, featuring Hamburg Farmers Market, Leesport Farmers Market, the Penn Street Market, as well as the West Reading Farmers Market. And then from 11:30 to 2, again, it's at the Ag Center on County Welfare Road, is the open house. So you really get to see a gem in Berks County, and we found out recently in discussions with our Ag Coordinator, Tammy Hildebrand, we are unique in the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania. We are the only ones with a centralized agricultural center. Out of all 67 counties, we have the only agricultural center. We're quite proud of it. It's about 45 years old. It's starting to show a little wear and tear, so we're in discussions now with the ag community, with Tammy Hildebrand, and we have about four tenants. Their agricultural groups, as well as the Detectives Forensic Unit. We're going to be doing some overhaul of that building, so stay tuned for those changes in the next year to 18 months. While we're up at the North Campus, while we're staying there, we can focus on our jail, which we are now glad that the average daily population of our jail is the lowest it's been since before 2004. Prior to 2004, there was a big surge in three strikes, you're out. A lot of drug possession charges were taken to trial. And our jail was filled with about 1,350 inmates. We are now down to about 850 of our own inmates. We have about 40 Pennsylvania State technical parole violators. And what they are is folks that have not violated the law, but have violated terms of their parole. So they have to be reincarcerated. Instead of going back to state prison, they come to our jail, and we are reimbursed by the state $70 per day for that service. We also have taken in several dozen Schuylkill County prison inmates. Their jail is woefully overcrowded, like ours was prior to 2004, and we're helping out our neighbors to the north. So one of the key components of our jail, if you can imagine, if you've ever been there, it's up on the hill on County Welfare Road, across from the nursing home. The original jail was built in 1933. The newer portion was built in 1993. Even the 1993 jail has its design flaws. It was the state-of-the-art type construction of jails back in 1993. Of course, back in 1933, that building is certainly significant, but when it comes to roofing, heating, ventilation, air conditioning, plumbing, those sorts of things, that building is well beyond its useful life. And we now have a firm engaged with the county to try to determine the next steps with our jail and what we're going to do in the future. Again, we are proud of the fact we're out down to less than 900 daily population of inmates, but we also are mindful that more and more the population at the jail is continuing to have severe mental health issues, severely mentally ill folks who have violated the law. On any given day, about 10% of our population is severely mentally ill. We are not set up and accommodated space-wise for that specialized population. So that's one of the things we're looking at for the future. Now, keeping in mind 1933 jail and the 1993 jail, we're looking at whether we can eliminate the 1933 jail and build new and keep the 1993 jail. Of course, doing quick math, that would be about half the cost of a brand new jail. Brand new jail, you don't even want to know what those numbers are, but they exceed $100 million. You've heard people many times say it's cheaper to educate, it's cheaper to build schools, it certainly is. It's cheaper to build hotel rooms than it is to build a jail. It's on average between $90,000 and $100,000 an inmate. Equate that to not just the cell itself, but kitchen area, laundry area, meeting area, training area. You have to have a certain amount of square footage per inmate population in a jail to meet standards. And it would cost in excess of $100 million if we built a brand new jail. The biggest single item ever spent by the county commissioners, I think, was the County Services Center back in the early 90s. That came in at over $70 to $75 million. Our recently completed radio system project, the 911 radio system, was $63 million. So think about 63, 70 to 75, and now we're looking at $100 million. It's costly. We are not leaving any stone unturned. We're talking to other counties to see if we can do something on a regional level, which we could potentially save some money in building together and staffing together. That's something we are pursuing. We recognize that there are some private jail builders, developers out there, people that actually build and construct the jails. There are a handful of firms out there that actually manage and run jails for you. My experience with those and what I've read thus far about privately run jails is a non-starter for me. We still would have the responsibility, the liability, having someone run our jail, and I'm not really in a position to have someone run our jail for us. It's similar to the discussion on the nursing home. Our Berks County nursing home is a five-star nursing home, one of the most excellent ones in the county. Being a little selfish, I think it's the best nursing home in the county. But many, many counties in the last 10 to 15 years have privatized their nursing homes. What I mean by that is most of these counties have run up against older structures, 50, 60-year-old nursing homes. They have obviously gone beyond their useful life. So many counties have turned their nursing facilities over to private managers and actually turned the facility over to them. We have been able not to do that. We are proud of the staff at the nursing home. We're proud of the management firm we have running the facility. Facility was built in 2005, and we get many, many compliments about the treatment and the facility at Berks County Heim, the nursing home. And we are still running just marginally in the black. So we're proud of that. So that's, again, on the North Campus. So we've taken a little tour around the North Campus. We have the jail, the nursing home, the Ag Center. We also have the County Residential Center. It is actually what some people call the Immigration Center. We call it the Residential Center. The federal government asked us to call it that. And there's been a lot of controversy surrounding the Residential Center. That was originally built in the 1970s as a Berks Heim Annex, when the total population of folks in the nursing home was upwards of 800 to 900 folks. So now our nursing home is 420 beds. It's sized right for the community because many, many people are staying home as opposed to going into long-term nursing care. Back to the residential center, you've seen much in the national news, a lot in the local news, a lot of protest, a lot of advocates against the program. Let me frame this for you. The county has been operating that residential center in different forms. The original one was at the old nursing home, which we demolished several years ago, which was on the other side of the road. For 16 years, this facility has been running. It's a combination of federal employees through the Immigration and Customs Enforcement, ICE, and about 75 county employees. These folks are not guards. They don't abuse people. They don't torture people. They are caseworkers. They are counselors. We have a 93-bed capacity. That means males, females, children, on two floors in that residential center. No one really knew or was aware of the facility for the prior 14 years. The last 2 years has seen a marked increase in folks coming across the border from Honduras, Guatemala, and El Salvador. Recognizing there are a lot of gangs, there's a lot of drug violence in these three Central American countries, they're able to move from those three countries through Mexico and arrive at the United States border, mostly in Texas, and they're requesting asylum. They are asked what their reason for asylum is, and they have to establish a credible fear. This is one of these terms that the federal government uses for someone who comes to the border and says, I am from El Salvador. I'm a mother with two children, and I'm requesting asylum. Many, many folks are granted their asylum request. They're usually matched up with family members who are already in the United States or with sponsors or even church organizations because they've established a credible fear. Meaning, I'm going to be hypothetical here. My husband was just murdered by a gang, and I'm afraid that my two young children are going to be brought into the gang. Okay, that's credible fear. The folks who come to the border and are have not established credible fear, meaning their justification for coming to the border has not passed the justification for the federal immigration folks, the folks then file an appeal. So the appeal takes 6 months. So when they say, we believe we should be granted asylum, but we were denied, they file for an asylum appeal. Those are the folks who end up in Berks County. They are nonviolent people. They are folks who are looking for asylum, but were denied the first time. So when you hear about us keeping the folks here for extended periods of time, it's because they file an appeal. And I think recently in the newspaper, it called out, and I don't believe everything I read, but I believe some of it, that the federal program is about 500 federal judges short to handle the influx of folks who are trying to come into our country. So hence, that's a 6 month delay. That mother or mother and father and children then have a subsequent asylum hearing 6 months later. And if they're not denied again, they are at that point asked if they want to return to their native country or do they want to file another appeal. So when you again hear that people are at the residential center for a year, that's because they filed two appeals to their asylum hearing. There are education programs there. Berks County Intermediate Unit runs the school there. Many of these children do not speak English. If they are unfortunately there for 6 months to a year or somewhat longer, most of them learn English while they're there. They're taught basic skills here because they are young children for the most part. They're fed, they're clothed, they have extensive amount of free time. They're not incarcerated. There is a very large play area with a soccer field, basketball court, and play area. There are many trips that are taken from the facility to places such like the Franklin Institute, the Planetarium, the Crayola Museum in Easton, and on and on and on. So it's not the best of situations for someone who believes when they get to the border they should just be set free. These are folks, again, who were denied their initial and subsequent appeals for asylum. So that's the only reason they're there. We have taken a pretty good beating as a Board of Commissioners for supporting this program. But this program, we believe, is something that we are supporting the federal government in doing. And we believe, in large measure, these folks are somewhat safer where they're at in the residential center. I don't want to get on that my soapbox, but I had to tonight. Moving on to throughout the county owns 58 bridges. The state of PennDOT owns many hundreds of bridges in Berks County, and the municipalities own the difference. So we're the smallest group of bridge owners. We have 58, but ours are in the worst state of disrepair of all of those. So you have PennDOT bridges, municipal bridges, and then you have county bridges. For decades, the county took their liquid fuels money, which is a tax on the wholesale price of fuel, got it in from the state, less than $1 million, and handed it over to municipalities, almost like the old days of walk-around money. So the prior county commissioner boards gave that money away. So when we came into office, Commissioner Leibach and I back in 2008, we started to dig into this and realized that we were not repairing our bridges. We were closing bridges. We were weight-restricting bridges. And this was not the right thing to do. So we stopped the flow of money out to the municipalities, and we started to reinvest in the county bridges. So thus far, here in 2017, we have eliminated three bridges. We are in the process of turning back over to townships, Main Creek and Greenwich, two other bridges. And we're really in the process of looking at another bridge in Exeter Township for a potential turn back by supporting Exeter in their request to improve the intersection. In a lot of the cases, for example, in Exeter, if we can help them to improve the intersection and we're using our liquid fuels money to improve the intersection where our bridge is, they might potentially then take the bridge from the county. Colebrookdale Township, we recently reached an agreement with Colebrookdale Township for one of our bridges in Colebrookdale. We're going to be removing our bridge, one of their culverts, and the majority of their road that leads to our bridge, all on the backs of our liquid fuels money. So we're really trying to work with the townships and the boroughs and the city to kind of divest ourselves of some of our infrastructure, because it's certainly costly to own and maintain bridges. Just then we have a viewer. Good evening, home viewer. How are you this evening?
Very well, thank you. Regarding the folks from Central and South America,
yes,
who came across the border and are now in Reading, I've traveled around the country in the last year, specifically the states in the Mid-East,
okay,
like Tennessee and North Carolina and Florida and South Carolina, Georgia. And as I do that, my son is in the service, and as I get the local paper, read the local news, it just seems to me that the federal government has been, over the last 8 years, taking these folks and strategically placing them in various states to alter the demographics of a given area of a state, and indeed the entire state. Do you see any of that with these folks being relocated to Reading as an initial subtle attempt to do that here in Berks?
Short answer is no, and I can't speak for what you've seen in other states, but I'm very glad to hear about your son serving his country. The folks who come to our residential center, if they are granted their asylum, you know, second or third request, most of their family lives along the border, Texas, New Mexico, and Arizona. Very few, if any, of these folks who are granted their asylum request actually end up in the Berks County or Pennsylvania area, as far as my records indicate.
Okay, now if these folks are successful in getting out of this facility, where are they going to go? Do you know?
They generally, part of that is they go with family members or sponsors.
And you said that a lot of those folks were along the Texas border.
Most of the folks we have at our residential center lay claim to having family members along the border, Texas, New Mexico, and Arizona, yes, and I guess parts of California. But the major influx of them coming through Mexico is to the Texas border. And interestingly enough, now I'm not a lawyer by any stretch of the imagination, but apparently when you're requesting asylum, you must request asylum at the neighboring border that you are. Okay, so not saying this right, but if you're in El Salvador, your neighboring border is Mexico, not the United States. So these folks are transported from these three Central American countries through Mexico and end up at the Texas border. So technically an asylum seeker really should seek asylum at its neighboring country, not moving a full country apart and then requesting asylum in the United States.
Yeah, I'll just leave you with one, going back to that,
sure.
The government placing folks, specifically within Tennessee, it'll be the Nashville to Chattanooga area.
Okay.
In Florida, it is the Orlando area. In Georgia, is Central Georgia. And in North Carolina, oddly enough, is the Research Triangle area.
Are they in facilities? Are they in their own housing? I mean,
from what I can determine from the local paper and the news, they are in the community.
Okay.
They're not in like a regional facility like we have here. They're out in the community.
Okay.
Yeah.
Because as far as we know, what we do here, there's only three of them like this. Ours is a family residential center, kind of midterm, 6 months to a year. There's two other ones that are privately run in Texas, which processes family members as well. But they are much larger. They have 1,000 to 1,200 beds. Ours is licensed for 93. So you can understand the difference there. The people that are just constantly coming into Texas and have to be processed. It's a big job. It's a full-time job, and more so.
Then one other point.
Sure.
Down in the Houston-Dallas area, quite a few from Central Africa, Sudan and so on,
okay.
Ethiopia, and up in the Minneapolis-St. Paul, a very large Somali community has emerged since President Clinton was in office. Wow. Not that he had anything to do with it, but they came to the United States to escape Somalia during that upheaval during the Clinton administration. It is just odd where they're settling people from Somalia in the Twin Cities. It doesn't seem logical. Okay, thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you very much for your call in, and I'm certainly not here to state my position one way or the other on immigration.
I'll point that out to you.
Yeah, it's a federal program. I have my own personal beliefs, but I don't think that this program should expel. What I'm trying to say is my support of the county employees, what the county has done to support the existing immigration program for the federal government. And there are folks that feel there should be open borders. There's folks that feel there should be a pathway to citizenship. There's folks that think that everyone who comes across the border or tries to get into our country should be rejected. So this has been going on for 30 years in Washington with no end in sight, because they can't seem to agree on many of these aspects. You know, then there's numbers between 10 and 20 million illegals in the country. Then you've got the Dreamers, the children who were born here to undocumented immigrants. It's a whole myriad of issues. But the one thing that I have learned from listening and understanding these things, where a country does need a healthy amount of immigration when your existing population is not repopulating itself to the numbers it should. Western Europe, Japan, and to some extent China was doing that because they were limiting, I think, one child per family. So the United States, the actual homegrown folks who live here, we're not having enough children, so you do need a healthy influx of folks from other countries to help to bring that population from being old down to more of a lower age bracket. So you need wage earners. You need folks out in the community working. So I wish, I do certainly hope and pray that the federal government can get their arms around the issue and come up with something that may not please both sides, but at least reach some compromise in the center. It's interesting, I saw on the news this weekend, there's two congressmen who are from Texas, one's a Democrat, one's a Republican, and with the snowstorm on Tuesday, they had to get back to Congress. So they hopped in the car together and drove 1,600 miles, a Democrat and Republican, and they got to Washington on Thursday, and they actually co-sponsored one another's bills. And from what I understand from folks that I know in Congress and some of the staff members, there was a time when they ate breakfast together, they had lunch, they went out together, they exercised together, and they were actually more congenial. They spoke to each other, whether you always agree with their philosophy or not. You tried to reach a consensus because you had to try to move the country forward. A lot of that is gone. A lot of it's fractured now. You have the left and the right, and you have electronic media, and you have iPhones and email, and apparently now it's become unpersonal that Congress and the Senate are not sitting down, having a sandwich with each other, having a cup of coffee, and just trying to figure things out for the betterment of the country. Again, I don't want to stress my beliefs on immigration, but I think it's something that the federal government really should get their arms around, because I think we need a direction. And the folks who are here, in whatever capacity they are, I think they need to understand what their future is. Or, you know, that, and that really needs to be settled out. So just that quickly, I think we have used up our available time on County Connection. I only concentrated on the North Campus and our bridges, but Friday we're having another meeting at readingbridges.net, which is our public-private partnership working on the explanation as to how to move around once the Penn Street Bridge is up to full renovation effort, which will be at least 2.5 years. By mid-April, Buttonwood Street's going to be open. Penn Street's going to be into heavy construction, but Penn Street's still going to be open. The merchants are going to be open for business, and we want to encourage people to stay vibrant in downtown Reading. So good night, and see you next time.